Good morning, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Professor Gary Maveal from the faculty. It's my pleasure to be the moderator of our first program. We knew that Professor McKinnon was going to be a tough act to follow, but I'm confident we've got the right panel to do it. Each of my colleagues here has research that focuses on the human aspect of their study of the history of Detroit, and I'm looking forward to their sharing it with you this morning. Our goal is to, again, address the critical role that the city's history has had on attitudes of the residents. And each of our panelists today have some insight on that critical history. Our plan is to allow each of them the floor presentation for about 20 minutes. And at the conclusion of an hour, we'll open it up with some follow-up questions, try to integrate their messages to us. Each of their bios are in your brochures, but let me just say a few words of introducing the three of them to you today. In the middle, we have our first speaker, Professor Roy Finkenbine, from the Department of History, College of Liberal Arts and Education. He's the co-chair of the department, and he's the director of the Abolitionist Archive, which is an online resource at the university, which you simply need to check out. It teaches African American history and 19th century U.S. history, among other courses. Among his notable research accomplishments are serving as co-editor of the Black Abolitionist Papers Project at Florida State University, a five-volume compendium on the subject. His scholarship also includes a chapter in a book, The History of Michigan Law. His contribution is a chapter on the state's role as a destination for Southern slaves seeking refuge in the 19th century. Professor, I think I will kick us off with stories about the Civil War riots. Our second speaker is Tom Stanton, Professor of Communication Studies. You're far or far right. In addition to the journalism courses listed in your brochure, Professor Stanton has a long history of serving as faculty advisor to the Varsity News, a student newspaper at the university, which has published since 1918, almost as long as our own law review. Professor Stanton's book that he has in hand, his upcoming book is Terror in the City of Champions, to be published this summer, and it's from that work that he'll be sharing some history on the Black Legion, white supremacists in the city in the 1930s. Our final speaker will be the one nearest me, that's Greg Sumner, also from the Department of History. He's a professor. He's co-chair with Professor Finkenbine of that department. Professor Sumner is also a lawyer by training, graduated from the University of Michigan's Law School. He holds 3 degrees from his native state of Indiana, Bachelor of Arts, Master of Arts, and PhD as well. In addition to teaching courses in Michigan history and the history of Detroit, his new book, Detroit in World War II, was published last year, and he's still on the speaking circuit with that book. Welcome. Welcome all three of you. So we'll ask Professor Finkenbine to kick us off then with his history of going back first in time to the Civil War days and the legacy of slavery and Detroit's role and riot in the aftermath of Professor Finkenbine.
Thank you. It's really good to be here today. This is the first in what for Greg and I promises to be a kind of a riot tour over the next year and a half. We've signed up with the Detroit Historical Museum's Detroit 1967 project, which is a very ambitious attempt to commemorate the Detroit 67 rebellion, riot, whatever you want to call it, as well as look at the background of racial violence in the city. Today, I want to look at the 1863 riot. Greg has a comment he likes to make He says, when people ask me about the riot in Detroit, I say, which one? 1863, 1943, 1967, and others that I'll mention briefly. The 1863 riot, I want to go through kind of step by step and look at a precipitating case, look at the riot itself, look at what I believe to be the causes, and look at some of the lessons to be learned in what I hope are 20 fun-filled minutes. The precipitating event for the 1863 race riot, and it was a true race riot, was a court case involving a man with the interesting name of William Faulkner. On February 26, 1863, Faulkner, a 42-year-old tavern keeper, was arrested, as the charge said, for committing an outrage. That was a 19th century reference to rape. He had allegedly raped 2 9-year-old girls, Mary Brown, who was white, Ellen Hoover, who was black, and this allegedly had occurred 10 days earlier in his Michigan Avenue tavern. He was brought to trial on March 5th. All of you who are legal students know in the 19th century, trials were often scheduled much closer to the actual arrest than we tend to do today. Well, what do we know about Faulkner? Faulkner appears to have been very light-skinned. Everyone in his neighborhood assumed he was white. He'd routinely voted, which in the 19th century was an indication that in fact that perception was widely shared by officials as well. But after his arrest, some in the public and the press began to allege that he was African American. He denied it, claiming mixed Spanish Indian blood. Well, at the end of the trial's first day, Faulkner was greeted by threats and curses as his guards, Wayne County Sheriff's deputies, escorted him back to the city jail at the corner of Bobien and Clinton. Accosted by a mob of hundreds of what was termed in the press as respectable citizens, the deputies were forced to point their revolvers at the crowd to maintain order. Even so, Faulkner was hit in the head by a paving stone thrown by someone in the crowd, which the press facetiously described as Irish confetti. It stunned him, although he successfully made it back to his cell. On the second day of the trial, March 6th, authorities determined to circumvent the mob, and they actually took Faulkner to the courtroom at 6 a.m. Later that morning, a crowd of close to 1,000 convened outside the court, quote, intent on bringing mob justice to Faulkner. Blacks who happened to walk by the court building were subjected to kicks, cuffs, and blows, according to the press. Well, Faulkner pled not guilty. His attorney insisted that the girl's testimony was, quote, inconsistent, somewhat absurd, and taken together, unworthy of credence. Nevertheless, the jury found him guilty in no more than 10 minutes, and Judge Benjamin Witherell sentenced him to the maximum sentence allowed in Michigan for rape, life in prison at the state penitentiary in Jackson. At the request of acting mayor Francis Phelps, the mayor was out of town. This would have been Ike's job if he would have been there in 1863. 75 men from the recently mustered in Provost Guard stationed in the city were requested to help accompany Faulkner back to his cell. They marched with bayonets fixed as the crowd hurled both insults and rocks at Faulkner. According to black eyewitnesses, quote, they were yelling like demons and crying, kill all the damn niggers. Faulkner was returned safely to his cell, but the crowd continued to hurl stones and brickbats at the provost guard. Eventually, the officer in charge ordered his men to load a round of blanks, to level their guns at the crowd, and to fire as a warning. When the crowd refused to disperse, several soldiers, apparently acting on their own, loaded live rounds and fired. A 24-year-old German shopkeeper named Charles Langer, apparently an innocent bystander, was killed instantly. Let me add as an aside, Detroit had no professional police force in 1863. Public order was maintained by the Wayne County Sheriff and 10 deputies. During the Civil War, the Secretary of War, the U.S. Secretary of War, had also authorized a volunteer infantry company of 100 men, the Provost Guard that I mentioned, to help keep the peace, in part because the city was growing by leaps and bounds in the midst of wartime. This then provoked the 1863 riot. When Langer fell, a riot began in earnest. The Provost Guard responded by marching swiftly and, I would say, curiously back to their barracks, leaving the infuriated mob in control of the streets. A local militia company, the Detroit Light Guard, maintained a protective cordon around the jail and Faulkner. The mob then turned its fury against the black neighborhoods on the east side, screaming, "Kill the Negroes, kill the Negroes." Members of the mob streamed southward from the jail through some streets not far from here, Brush, Beaubien, St. Antoine, Lafayette, and Fort Streets. Many members of the mob armed with axes and beer. One of the first attacks was on a cooper shop at Beaubien, where Joshua Boyd and other black men were working. Boyd was knocked in the head with an axe by a member of the mob, producing a bleeding, gaping wound. He died some 30 hours later. According to one black eyewitness, he, quote, died a mangled child of sorrow. Many black residents in this part of the Third Ward were beaten mercilessly while their homes were looted and set ablaze. Those who fled were pelted with brickbats and stones. One black eyewitness reported that he saw one burning man flee his blazing home only to be attacked by 20 Irish immigrants wielding clubs and screaming, "Kill the Nigger!" Some blacks fled to the docks hoping to make their way across the Detroit River to Canada West, what today we call Ontario. Ferrymen, sensing an opportunity, tripled and quadrupled their usual charges. Detroit's Third Ward burned throughout the late afternoon and early evening of March 6th from Croghan Street, now Monroe, down Brush and Beaubien, as far south as Congress. Houses on Lafayette between Beaubien and St. Antoine were nearly stripped of all furniture and possessions, which then provided fuel for bonfires, which were set in the middle of the street. The riot was quelled late in the evening by the arrival of more local militia. A detachment of the 19th U.S. Regular Infantry stationed at Fort Wayne, and five companies, the new 27th Michigan Volunteer Infantry, which had been rushed to Detroit from Ypsilanti by special train. Faced with these forces, and having satiated much of its anger, the mob melted away. By the next morning, all was quiet except for the smoldering remnants of burning houses and businesses in Detroit's black neighborhood. When the smoke cleared, officials tallied the damages. Two lay dead, one black, one white. What the press described as scores of black men had been mercilessly beaten. Some 30 to 35 black homes and businesses had been burned entirely to the ground, and many others were seriously damaged. Hundreds of blacks had fled across the river to Windsor or into the countryside. There's a great source, for those of you that want to look at some of these individual stories, very poignantly presented. And you can find this online or in print form in libraries. An anonymous local black, shortly after the riot had occurred, compiled dozens of these stories from the mouths of the victims in a book called A Thrilling Narrative from the Lips of the Sufferers of the Late Detroit Riot. In true 19th century fashion, the title goes on interminably after that, abbreviated for your benefit. The riot represented a new form of racial disorder in the city. Before the Civil War, Detroit had experienced at least six so-called fugitive slave riots, in which the local black community employed violence and threats of violence against efforts to return specific fugitive slaves to bondage. These included fugitive slave riots in 1828, 1833, the famous Blackburn riot, you know that story. 1839, 1847, 1850, and 1859. Detroit had generally avoided the racial pogroms by white mobs against black neighborhoods that disturbed many American cities between the 1820s and the 1850s. 1863 changed all that. Furthermore, the riot was, as the Detroit Free Press reported, quote, the bloodiest day that ever dawned upon Detroit to that time. Well, what caused all this? Why this new form of rioting disorder in the city? I see four longer-term primary reasons. One is the ethnic makeup of the city had been undergoing change for a period of years. Growing numbers of immigrants from Europe, primarily Irish and German immigrants, had been coming to Detroit since the late 1840s. This had changed the ethnic makeup of the city. At the same time, the local black population had grown tenfold, from about 139 to 1,402 between 1840 and 1860 censuses, a mere two decades. Often, Irish immigrants and blacks engaged in economic competition for the same jobs, the same neighborhoods, and the same recreation space. There were a growing number of minor racial incidents on Detroit streets in the six-month period preceding the riot. In a study of 19th century policing in Detroit, the author found that of the 46 men arrested for participating in the riot, there were hundreds, if not thousands, more. 46 were arrested. At least 20 of those were Irish, and no more than six were German immigrants. Nearly half the names of those arrested didn't appear in the city directory, a mark, the author notes, of the possible tranches of that population. A second reason, I think, is the war itself. The social disruption of wartime had brought a dramatic growth in the size of the local population, in crime, in inflation, and in labor conflict. Local society was unsettled. Maybe more importantly, the riot occurred the same day that the Federal Enrollment Act became law. For the first time, all able-bodied male citizens and immigrants intending to become citizens, this applied to age 20 to 45 if unmarried and 20 to 35 if married, were subject for the first time to a military draft. This, coupled with the Emancipation Proclamation 2 months earlier, which made the Union effort in the Civil War into a struggle for black freedom, troubled many working-class Detroiters. Furthermore, the new law extended federal power into communities as never before, making it relatively unpopular. Prior to the military draft in 1863, there's only one institution in the federal government that really touched the lives of most Americans on a regular basis. Anybody want to guess what that was? Post office. A hopefully fairly non-threatening institution. Certainly not the IRS. As Paul Taylor observed in a very fine book that Wayne State University Press published just a couple of years ago, A History of Civil War Detroit, Taylor noted, quote, the new Enrollment Act and its perceived intent of forcing poor white men into the army to fight for black slaves' freedom became the powder keg's short fuse. Or listen to the words of one rioter to get it straight from the horse's mouth. Quote, if we're going to be killed up for niggers in this, then we will kill every nigger in this town. They're making that connection between the war, the draft, and African Americans. There was a fourth cause, and perhaps this is the greatest one of all. The Detroit Free Press, an extremely racist paper in the 19th century, had been actively fueling racial hysteria among its working class and immigrant readers for months. The paper frequently ran anti-black stories, demeaning, charging African Americans with threatening white jobs, demeaning white citizenship, being the cause and continuance of the deadly war, and seeking interracial relationships with white women. If nothing else worked, that always seemed to be an effective charge. When Faulkner was arrested, the Free Press immediately identified him as, quote, a black fiend and a monster, and urged its readers to take action. 5 days before the riot on March 1st, its March 1st issue, it said of Faulkner, quote, it is thought that an excited and indignant mob would have intended to wreak summary vengeance upon him within the very walls of the courtroom. They're calling for mob justice. The day after the riot, the Detroit Advertiser and Tribune, the city's Republican paper, characterized the rioters as a free press mob. Well, what lessons can we learn from the 1863 riot? I think there are several. In many ways, the Detroit riot, the worst of the several that occurred in the Midwest during the Civil War, was a dress rehearsal for the much more famous New York City draft riots of July 13th through 16th, 1863. I always love to tell my students in the Civil War class that many of the units who had just defeated the Confederacy at Gettysburg, July 1st through 3rd, were then shifted up to New York City to quell that race riot in the midst of war. The riot certainly highlighted worsening race relations in the city of Detroit that would last beyond the confines of the war. The riot, and I wish Ike was here, the riot prompted Detroit to establish its first professional police force as a way to preserve public order in the city. So if you want to blame the police, it all starts here. Finally, 6.5 years after the riot, after Faulkner had languished in Jackson Penitentiary, Mary Brown came forward, admitted that she had perjured herself, fabricated the whole story, and persuaded Ellen Hoover to go along in order to avoid trouble with their parents for being late in coming home. Faulkner was pardoned on December 3rd, 1869. In the end, the Free Press, its readers, and the mob had misrepresented both his race and the rape, leading to one of the worst race riots in Detroit history. Thank you.
On the Black Legion in the 1930s, Detroit.
Well, as I'm sitting and being off to the side here, and I see the camera taking shots, I'm thinking, gosh, I don't want to look like Chris Christie, you know, staring at the back. But fortunately, I'm listening to Professor Finkenbine, so the analogy ends there. I'm honored to be with two such well-known historians. My background is different, journalistic. This book of mine that's coming out in June is my seventh book. Most of them have been baseball related. We're just coming a couple months off the holiday season, in our house anyway. And I'm presuming that some of you, when you were kids, can recall these family gatherings at your house, where in the basement, and you know, the smell of a kielbasa and sauerkraut and lasagna wafting, you know, the twinkling lights against the wall, and your uncles and your old aunts reminiscing about their childhood. And when I was growing up in Warren, this was a common part of my life. And always, my uncles, who were a combination of radicals and factory workers and big band singers, they would be reminiscing about the 1930s. And my dad came from a family of 10. He grew up near the city airport on the city's east side. And many of their stories related to the Detroit teams of the mid-1930s. And if you're not a sports fan, the way we got the title City of Champions relates to the fact that within an 8-month period, the Tigers, the Lions, and the Red Wings all won the national championships as Joe Louis, great African-American boxer, was undefeated and pursuing the heavyweight crown. And so I heard these stories all the time about the City of Champions. But occasionally there was another story that would pop up, and it came from my Uncle Clem, who was a leftist, aspiring artist, and he would tell of walking in Paradise Valley, which was the African American neighborhood, which was replaced by 375, which you may have taken to get here. Walking there in search of, I didn't admit it until I was much older, in search of reefer, looking for marijuana. And he got pulled over at one point. He was with a pack of his friends, got pulled over by some guys who claimed that they were undercover police officers. They were an unmarked car, two cops, and my two uncles, two of their friends are there, and the guy pulled over and said, "What are you doing? What are you doing in this neighborhood? You're not supposed to be here." And of course, these guys are in their early 20s, and they're pretty tough guys themselves. And so the situation escalates. My uncle doesn't believe that these guys are cops. He's heard about the Black Legion. He assumes that these guys are Black Legion Knight Riders who were known for abducting leftists. And so they put up a fight. It turns out they end up at the police station. These guys were actually undercover cops. But this was the first time I'd heard of the Black Legion. And and as I'd been working on other books that tend to be Detroit-centric, I would come upon these references to the Black Legion, which the Legion is not nearly as famous as another group that existed at the time and a couple of years prior. Some of you have probably heard of the Purple Gang. Purple Gang was a Jewish mob that controlled the alcohol trade during Prohibition. They did it for profit. The Black Legion was like a Ku Klux Klan on steroids, incredibly violent organization that had its roots in Ohio, started from a small town doctor who was part of the Klan and didn't think the Klan was exciting enough, so he started inventing a little history of his own and got his local Klan members to dye their outfits black, you know, called themselves the Black Guard. That fizzled after they had a couple of crimes, fizzled after a few years until this electrician in Lima, Ohio decided he wanted to resurrect the Black Legion. And he did it with great fury, and it took off. And it took off nowhere better than in Detroit. You need to know that Detroit in this period, the early 1930s, it's a tumultuous place. You have the depth of the Great Depression happening in 32, 33, bank holidays closed to prevent a closure, massive amounts of people laid off. You've lived through the Great Recession, and that pales in just a phenomenal ways to what was happening in the 30s. This is also the time when unions are forming, there's a lot of dissension within industry. And what happens is that the Legion, which is a secret society, ends up being adopted secretly by many of the folks who are in the automobile plants trying to prevent unions from forming. What is motivating this Klan-like organization, the Black Legion? It's hatred to some degree. You might find yourself involved in the Black Legion if you're a white Protestant male. A friend might come up to you and say, "Hey, I'm going to go to this party, I'm going to go to this barbecue, it's out in the woods, or I'm going to go to this meeting of other good Americans, or hey, they're having a little gathering of folks who want to try to keep the schools white, you know, keep the blacks out of our schools, keep the blacks out of our neighborhoods." And so somehow or another, you'd wind up at this meeting of Black Legionnaires, not knowing what you had just fallen into. And within 15, 20 minutes, you might be in a field, and you realize that this is no barbecue. You're faced with people who have black gowns, black hoods on, and are heavily armed. And you are soon, at gunpoint, taking an oath to give your life for this organization. You're being told that that the only former members of the Black Legion are buried, and that you will accept duties, you will accept responsibilities, you will commit crimes in pursuit of fighting all of these isms that the Black Legion was opposed to. Catholicism, Judaism, Unionism, Communism, Socialism, Negroism. And that's how it would start. And maybe you would embrace the cause, maybe you'd be behind it, maybe it was what you believed. But often the people who were involved in the Black Legion were people who were terrified of it. I investigated a whole lot of crimes that the Black Legion did. Within the Detroit area, there were more than a dozen regiments of about 1,600 men each. In Detroit proper, there were four or five. We know very little bit about them because really only members of one regiment actually ended up talking with police. And there were higher ups. There were police. The police commissioner was a member of the Black Legion. That wasn't known at the time. And I'm not sure that he was aware of what was happening in his name. But nonetheless, there were politicians who used the Black Legion as a way to get votes, just as happened with the Klan. Anyway, one of the most horrific crimes involved a guy named Silas Coleman, who was a day laborer in the Detroit area. And he knew this guy named Dayton Dean, who was the Legion's most famous gunman, who worked at the Mysterski power plant down near Fort Wayne. One of the cool things when you're looking into the history is just knowing that these streets that you're on, some of the stuff that has happened here previously. Silas Coleman was owed $17 by a guy who had hired him to haul bricks, and the guy hadn't paid him yet. So one of the colonels of the local regiment of the Black Legion wanted to know what it would feel like to kill a black man. And so it was just going to be a fun day for them, literally. That's how they viewed this. And so they lured Silas Coleman with the understanding that he was collecting these $17 in wages out to the Pinckney area where there was a cottage and where there was this group of Black Legion members drinking. And they told Silas, this was near midnight, we're going to take you out to the pond, the Ford Mill Pond, and we're going to, the guy's out on a boat who owes you the money, we'll call him ashore. And of course, they got him out there, and what they did was they released him into the swamp and hunted him down for fun. This was in 1935. His body was found the next morning. Police, if they knew of the Black Legion, didn't connect it. In fact, the Black Legion had not been mentioned at this point as even existing. It was a secret society. You could die if you told people about it. But, so Silas Coleman was a killing for fun. Many of the crimes that the Black Legion instigated had to do with one of two things, either trying to keep unions out of the factories or keeping their own members in line. So, example of this guy named Roy Pidcock, who was a member of the Black Legion. He ends up getting killed, fake suicide. This is how they did a lot of their killings. They'd make your death look as if you had taken your own life. He had been ordered by his Black Legion peers to leave his wife because she was Catholic, because she had children out of wedlock prior to marrying him. And he had refused to do it, but it pretty much drove him nuts until one night he's abducted from his home and his body is found a couple days later hanging in a shed on Fighting Island, which was near Ecorse. They had a whole lot of plots. There were, by the estimates of the director of the Black Legion, the head of it, this electrician, he estimated membership at 3 to 6 million. That's likely just wildly exaggerated, of course. But there were tens of thousands of members in the Detroit area. They would have these big musters where thousands of people would gather outside of Oxford or outside of Saline or in Monroe, out in these fields. And they'd move their sites so that the police who weren't members wouldn't necessarily be able to put things together quickly. But among the local plots they had, they tried to assassinate the publisher of a Highland Park newspaper who was against their local mayor, who was a Black Legion member. They had a member who was one of their upper members locally, was a guy who was with the health department in Detroit, and he tried to get a fellow biologist who worked for the health department to inject typhoid into cheese and milk deliveries that were going to the Jewish neighborhoods in and around Detroit. That didn't happen. The guy put him off as long as he could, and in time the Black Legion was exposed. They wanted to inject poisonous gas into synagogues. They'd gone as far as coming up with lists of the largest synagogues in the Midwest. They had targeted the Catholic mayor of Ecorse, Bill Vassan, who, you know, a lot of these characters weren't pristine themselves. Vassan would end up in jail for embezzlement and other things. And he had his own spy in the Black Legion who kept warning him whenever they were going to try to kill him. One of the heroes of the story is actually an attorney. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Sugar Law Center, but Maurice Sugar was a leftist attorney, self-described socialist in those years. And he represented, he's a white Jewish attorney, and he represented many African-Americans in their cases, often against police. He was a fierce critic of the police commissioner at the time, a guy named Heinrich Pickard, who was secretly in the Black Legion. And as a result of this, he became a target of the Black Legion, who sided with the police commission. Police shootings at that time, police shooting people that they were pursuing, averaged about one a month, and usually the victims were African American. One of the more interesting encounters I came upon, and it wasn't a full-fledged riot, but it related to the Nation of Islam, which maybe some of you know was founded in Detroit in the early 1930s. And at the time, though, if you're reading about the Nation of Islam in the Detroit papers, they're referring to it as a voodoo school. They had their own school where they would get kids to come out of the Detroit public schools. They'd enroll them in the University of Islam, the voodoo school, and they would get these kids to change their names, of course, go to an Islamic name. And the police came down hard on the school, with the blessing of the Legion, and confiscated their materials, and it ended up that there was hundreds of residents from Black neighborhoods protesting outside of the Detroit police headquarters, which was on Maveal, not far from here. The big moment never came for the Black Legion, in that there was a zero hour, September 16th, 1936, when they talked of overthrowing the U.S. government. Whether or not that was just a lot of bluster, because you had this guy who had built up this organization, and what do? How do you keep people interested? You know, tens of thousands of people, you can only, you know, kill so many of your own members and pursue labor activists so much before people want to do something bigger. And so he had this zero hour. And it might have happened, we don't know, because it was a murder in May of 1936, which led to the unveiling, the outing of the Black Legion. And it started not too far from here, over near Waterman and Lafayette, in a building that still stands, Finn Letter Temple. And they persuaded this young laborer, this Catholic guy, who, and this is an indication how personal these battles could get, how petty. He was married to a woman that this Black Legion member had had a crush on for 20 years, and or not 20 years, about 10 years. And he was targeted for that reason, but they concocted some story about him having beaten his pregnant wife, which was not true. And so they convinced this man, Charles Poole, that who's unemployed, WPA guy, that we can get you a job at a local factory, and you can play baseball, you'll be a ringer on the baseball team, you just got to go to this meeting. And they take him and they out to a field, and they shoot him. And the police investigation eventually, because they think it's somebody else who's been killed, a local mobster, there's actually an investigation, it's not buried, and the gunman ends up talking. And the Black Legion begins to unravel, at least part of it, until what initially happens is that the Democratic prosecutor, Duncan McCree, an attorney who was corrupt himself, was outed by the Republican mayor, by the Republican governor, as being a member of the Black Legion, because in the police investigation, they had found his membership card. And so initially, the Republicans are saying, we're going to do a full-out investigation. We're going to out everybody involved in this. What they soon discovered is that a whole lot of their people were behind the Black Legion. And the pressure that the press put on the Detroit authorities required that they go through with the investigation, and people did go to jail for two murders, for the murder of Charles Poole and for the murder of Silas Coleman. But meanwhile, the other 48 or so murders that the state police believe occurred as a result of the Black Legion in the Detroit area alone were never revealed as being tied to the Legion. Nobody was ever prosecuted. There was a one-man grand jury, which, as grand juries do, kept the testimony secret. And the only people who were ever prosecuted were as a result of the gunman speaking. The grand jury came up and recommended no prosecutions other than those that had occurred. And the guy who was behind it, that electrician, Bert Effinger, was never prosecuted. He was protected by police in Ohio. He was likely protected by folks in Detroit because he knew too much and they didn't want their political careers marred by it. One of the guys who was likely, who spoke before the Black Legion, would claim that he didn't know it was the Black Legion, spoke before one of their front groups, would go on to be Secretary of the U.S. Army under Eisenhower. Another member was the brother of the governor's chief of staff. Another was a prominent attorney who was the personal attorney of the police commissioner. And the way we discovered that the police commissioner was a member, a couple things happened. But one of the key ones is there's this interview that a historian had done 30 years ago in which he agreed never to reveal anything while he was alive or why this source was alive. And it was involving a police officer who had gotten promoted quickly after realizing that he had come upon the police commissioner's membership card. You know, when you're in researching a book, you come upon all sorts of interesting things. And one of the anecdotes I love best is about this gunman, Dayton Dean. It was a different time, and the police would allow the press to come in and interview people who were being charged with crimes. Dayton Dean was put into a room with one of the prominent African-American journalists in Detroit, a guy who wrote for the Michigan Chronicle, as well as the Chicago Defender. This is the day before modern media ethics. He was also the conflict of interest. He was the press guy for Joe Lewis. And so, and he said, this guy has a graduate degree from U of M, and you've got Dayton Dean who, you know, dropped out of school, elementary school. And he's being interviewed. The black journalist is interviewing the white racist, and it's just this little taste of history that just kind of drove home some of what was at stake here. I'm going to close with just mentioning that the FBI was aware of the Black Legion and found every way possible, J. Edgar Hoover, to not investigate. And it would have had the support in doing so of both Republicans in the state of Michigan and Democrats nationally, because the Democrat Party at that point was counting on Southern support, Klan support, and so the two things came together, and it was just too political for J. Edgar Hoover to get involved on a very personal basis. And it came upon, when I was searching FBI documents, came upon this effort by this police captain in Michigan to try to get the FBI involved, because there were a couple murders that took place. Fighting Island is in Canada. So if you're taking a body across international waters, some of your experts at this. I don't want to speak out of turn here, but evidently that could indicate that that's a matter that the FBI should have interest in, that you're taking somebody across not just state lines, but international lines. And so there was pressure put on to get the FBI to investigate, and he wrote this scathing note back to the FBI agent that there's no way, this is outside of your realm, you should never even be looking at this. And that pretty much ended it, though the police captain tried to keep it going for another few years. I will stop there and turn it over to you.
Last speaker is Professor Greg Sumner from the Department of History on the Detroit riot in 1943.
Okay. Thank you. It's great to be here. And I want to thank Professor Maveal for inviting some guys from the College of Liberal Arts and Education to be here today. And you let the cat out of the bag. I introduce myself often as a recovering lawyer. And so I'm here. I reinvented myself. And Roy and I in particular, we're the riot squad, right? We're here to talk about the race riots. Another thing I want to identify myself, I am not a native Detroiter. I came here in 1993 to begin teaching at Detroit Mercy. I came to the planet Detroit and still learning about it, but I think I'm a Detroiter, and I've just written a book on Detroit and World War II on which my talk is based. I still occasionally will say Gratiot when I go to that street, or Asher, or I don't understand these right, east side, left, west side. But I know I became a Detroiter because I can pass a map test. I know where all the places are. And when I go to another city and they downgrade and down knock Detroit, I want to fight them. So I am a Detroiter, even though I'm sort of from another place. And I think people who come from other places see things that you natives take for granted or don't really see. I want to repeat what Roy said. I like to say, when people say to me, Detroit race riot, I say, which one? And we're pretty good at having race riots in this area. And we're doing kind of a history of that. And secondly, what I've noticed, and I'm sure it's true of 1863, certainly true of 1943, which I'm going to talk about, and it's true of 1967. I very often, over 20 plus years, I listen to students talk about their parents and their grandparents. There's often kind of a template, like a white narrative of what happened and a black narrative of what happened, and they're very often very different. Not everybody follows that split, but it's very interesting how there is this kind of racial divide, and I hear it in the stories and the myths and the rumors that come down from 67 and 1943. Close observers were not surprised when Detroit experienced the worst race riot in the country during the Second World War in 1943. The bustling capital of America's arsenal democracy, it faced all the opportunities and challenges that came with becoming a boom town after decades of depression. Civic leaders were unprepared to deal with the waves of newcomers who poured into the and for the employment now available with the conversion of the auto industry to munitions production. At the time, Mayor Edward Jeffries likened the responsibilities of his job to that of managing a, quote, frontier town of the gold rush period. Detroit was quite booming in the 1940s. Many wondered if Detroit was ungovernable. Frictions across the long-established racial divide were a source of particular concern, and sure enough, when the conditions were right, they went off like, quote, dynamite, as a writer for Life magazine predicted. It's hard to exaggerate the scale of the ensuing destruction and the damage done to the morale and social fabric of the city. The thousands arriving from the South, white and black, found the rules of Jim Crow in effect in Detroit, too. But now workers and their families found themselves jammed daily into uncomfortable proximity as they competed for jobs, housing, and recreational space and stood in lines for just about everything during World War II. Tempers flared in a barely concealed atmosphere of race tension pervaded every aspect of life in the wartime arsenal. The revolt of white neighbors over the opening of the integrated Sojourner Truth Homes in early 1942 was a warning of things to come, as were the ugly hate strikes staged by white workers over the hiring and promotion of blacks at Ford and Packard. Fueling the danger were voices in the local media. Quote, "The Sunday broadcasts over Detroit's radio stations are a babble of racism, fundamentalism, ignorance, and guile," the New Republic reported to its readers. Quote, "No city, north or south, could match this hellish symphony." The big explosion unfolded over two steamy days and nights in the late June of 1943. The precise origins, the spark that set off what the Department of Justice later called spontaneous combustion, will never be known with certainty, but it's clear that, as in so many civil disturbances then and now, one or two minor incidents served to blow the lid off of deep-seated, long-simmering animosities before anyone could stop it. The fire spiraled into a conflagration. As darkness approached Sunday evening, June 20th, at the end of a long day and 90-degree heat, fistfights broke out between young black and white men packed in a gridlock of cars and bodies on the Belle Isle Bridge. Like a force of nature, the violence took on a momentum of its own, propelled by sensational and false rumors as it spilled into the city proper. "A black man raped a white woman," someone loudly declared. "White thugs threw an African-American mother and her child to their deaths in the Detroit River," others cried with equal volume rumors. Adding to the bad blood that night was the presence of 200 or so off-duty sailors stationed at the nearby Broadhead Armory on East Jefferson. Alcohol-fueled and looking for trouble, they were only too happy to launch themselves into the melee once it came into their sights. The police were undermanned and overwhelmed, and soon downtown itself was a war zone. Sounds of sirens and broken glass filled the air, and Black Bottom and Paradise Valley, the vibrant main street of Black Detroit, was under siege. Brandishing the crude and cruel tools of the mob, bricks, tire irons, sections of metal pipe, and a few guns, gangs of white men pushed their way up Woodward Avenue, ready to bludgeon any black person who got in their way. People were pulled from movie lines and out of streetcars and savagely beaten. Motorists of both races scrambled for their lives as the stealth self-styled vigilantes overturned and torched random vehicles as bystanders cheered them on. The scene reminded Free Press columnist Malcolm Bingay of episodes that haunted him from his youth in the Deep South. He said, "On the streets of Detroit, I saw again the same horrible exhibition of uninhibited hate as they fought and killed one another, white against black, in a frenzy of homicidal mania without rhyme or reason. Their faces were the same, their lips drawn back, their teeth bared like fangs, their eyes glazed. Bestial faces bereft of all human expression." This is the mob. No one knew when the chaos might play itself out or how far the swath of destruction might reach. With loaded hunting rifles, men in the suburbs stood watch on lawns and front porches while their young children cowered in darkness. The commander at Selfridge Field ordered the black Tuskegee pilots stationed there confined to the base until further notice. Meanwhile, Mayor Jeffries and Governor Harry Kelly vacillated about their next moves, hoping to be spared the embarrassment of calling Washington for help. The madness rolled on through dawn as Detroit's Bloody Sunday turned into Bloody Monday. Quote, "It was a real race riot," recalled James Cumming, an African-American eyewitness. "It wasn't like this in 1967, where it was mostly looting. In 1943, they had boundaries set up which, if you would pass, you would certainly get killed or hurt." He called it a real race riot. It's important to remember that for every story of the horror that unfolded in Detroit at the start of that second wartime summer, There were instances, too, and plenty of them, of people reaching out to one another across the color line, and I think this happened in 1967, probably 1863. Quote, riot foes fraternize in hospital, the Free Press reported Tuesday morning, looking for signs of hope amid the carnage. These were breaches of etiquette similar to those occurring in war zones overseas, each a spontaneous brotherhood of the wounded in which old habits and taboos lost their meaning. The sheer unexpectedness of these moments made them newsworthy, and the Free Press described the emergency room with white and black people bleeding, men mostly, bleeding, bandaged, and kind of interacting with each other. The Motor City's madness did not abate until Monday evening, June 21st, when the boots of 6,000 federal troops hit the ground. Bayonets fixed, tanks and trucks with machine guns rumbling alongside them in support. It was easy to forget that there was another larger war going on outside the city. Belated as it was, the show of force worked and martial law took hold. It was an eerie scene as soldiers patrolled the near deserted streets of a place that liked to call itself the arsenal of democracy. Governor Kelly instituted a nightly curfew and put a ban on all liquor sales. Detroit Tigers baseball games were canceled, and for days the air reeked of charred wood and tear gas. Businesses remained shuttered, and schools, post offices, and other municipal buildings stayed closed. Residents of black neighborhoods waited it out in their homes as their communities endured a protective lockdown. In the end, the official death toll was 34, the majority of the victims African Americans. The actual body count was almost certainly higher. 600 were seriously injured enough to be sent to the hospital, including a number of police officers, and the court docket for the week recorded over 1,000 arrests. Property damage ran into the multi-million dollars, and damage to the city's image, something statistics could not measure, was profound and lasting. There were political casualties, too. Mayor Jeffries was eventually turned out of office, in part because of his halting response to the days of anarchy in his city. Troops stayed for months to keep the peace, bivouacked on Belle Isle, the lawn of the Detroit Public Library, and any other public space that could be made to accommodate them. The postmortems and finger-pointing started even before the smoke cleared. Some attributed the disaster to, quote, war nerves. President Roosevelt knew it was more complex than that, but he declined to give the fireside chat on race his wife and other advisors privately urged him to make. Always keeping his eye on the goal of winning the war, he was most concerned about the threat to munitions production such disorders posed. It was estimated that Detroit's output fell 6% during its bloody week. An open letter on race hatred, a radio play aired nationally on the CBS network a month after the riot, posed the question in the most pointed terms. Quote, how many of your sons will die for the lack of the tanks and planes and guns, which Detroit did not make, the narrator asked. The tragedy demanded reflection and soul-searching by all Americans. Quote, we lost Bataan gallantly. We surrendered Corregidor with honor. We were defeated in Detroit by ourselves. Even worse, the contagion was spreading. Disturbances flared in Harlem, Chicago, St. Louis, Galveston, El Paso, and dozens of other cities over the course of that long, hot, wartime summer. And it often happened in boom towns where people were crowded together. The president lamented, too, the aid and comfort given to the enemy by newswire photographs of rampaging mobs and overturned cars aflame. Indeed, the strife in Detroit would be a staple of Japanese and German propaganda for at least the next year. Nazi-controlled Vichy radio in France called the riot a product of, quote, the internal disorganization of a country torn by social injustice, race hatreds, the violence of an irritated proletariat, and the gangsterism of a capitalistic police, whatever that means. But you saw in Japanese and in Nazi propaganda images of Detroit. Congressman Martin Dies, chairman of the infamous House Un-American Activities Committee, came to a different conclusion, charging that the Motor City violence was the handiwork of deep cover Japanese provocateurs. He presented no evidence in support of this theory, however. Inevitably, there were those eager to lay blame at the doorstep of the First Lady. Critics had long condemned what they saw as her, quote, meddling on race issues, and they'd not forgotten the warmth of the reception she received on a visit to Black Bottom in 1935, when she turned the first shovel for the new Brewster Douglas housing project. Quote, in Detroit, a city known for the growing impudence and insolence of its Negro population, a letter to the editor of the Jackson, Mississippi Daily News declared, quote, an attempt was made to put your preachments into practice, Mrs. Roosevelt. Now she had blood, quote, blood on her hands. To understand what lay behind the 43 race riot, however, it is not necessary to conjure up Axis agents or defame crusading social reformers. The root problem was segregation and the attitudes that supported it. The real instigator was Jim Crow. Fortunately, there were plenty of people who did not succumb to the furies of the mob, individuals who went out of their way to help fellow citizens in danger, and again, their stories need to be told too. The Open Letter on Race Hatred program dramatized a series of episodes that, taken together, brought the point home. A quick-thinking white woman hides a black passenger under her seat as marauders sweep through a streetcar. Students at Integrated Northeastern High School walk home together after their graduation ceremonies, their numbers a protection against harm. And three off-duty sailors stop a gang from assaulting a black pedestrian downtown. Quote, I'm just paying off a debt, one of them explains, his jaw set as he rolled up his sleeves. He was acting in the name of an African-American shipmate lost in the Pacific. Out of the ashes, there were other signs of hope in post-riot Detroit. Schools, churches, UAW locals, and other civic organizations sponsored town meetings aimed at preventing a relapse, and a big crowd packed a double victory civil rights rally in good old Olympia Stadium. It was packed. It would fall to the next generation to build upon these promising foundations. So I think we would say there are themes here in common. 1863, 1943, 1967, and there are obvious comparisons there too. So thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sumner, and all of our panelists for the presentations. I'd like just to make a couple of additional remarks before we open it up for questions, so please consider what you might ask the panelists to follow up. Greg alluded to the strife or the discord given the labor situation, especially at the large auto plants with the promotion or the, of African Americans in the workforce there. One of the anecdotes that I came across in preparing was identified by Professor Ed Littlejohn, which I'm sure the panelists know. And I wanted to introduce to the students, at least in the room, Professor Ed Littlejohn is retired from Wayne State's law faculty, and he has a long history of contributing articles in this same realm of African American history, especially in the city of in the state of Michigan. He's published a couple of noteworthy articles in the Michigan Bar Journal on the subject that are out on the table in the hallway. He also published an article in 1981 on a history of police misconduct, especially in the state of Michigan. And referring to the 1943 riots, he mentioned that the upshot of the promotion of these three blacks at the Packard plant in June were a walkout by 35,000 workers at the Packard plant, which is just hard to imagine the effect that that would have, the likely effect that it would have on attitudes, with rumors spreading to the root cause of the disruptions. Professor Littlejohn's 1981 article also identifies that 17 of the 25 blacks that were killed in that disturbance were killed by police. 17 of the 25 in the aftermath of the riot, the NAACP's Thurgood Marshall was part of an investigative team that visited the city and made recommendations as to how the political leadership might address the discord. As Greg said, not much of that got off the ground. And the other aspect of this article, which is noteworthy, was that the U.S. Attorney General, whose name was Biddle at the time, was involved in sorting out and addressing the discord, and a leaked memo of his had recommended that blacks needed to be advised to stop their migration to northern cities, including Detroit, that could not assimilate their numbers. And that didn't help the situation either when that memorandum made its way to the public. The presentations here haven't addressed directly beyond Dr. McKinnon's the 1967 riot, but Professor Littlejohn's article does, and I would commend it to you all. There's a conference a week today at Wayne State, a day-long conference. Students might feel interested to attend. Professor Littlejohn will be attending from his retirement in Florida. I'm looking forward to seeing that as a follow-up to today's presentation. Questions of our panelists in follow-up of their presentations? Professor Bellion.
This may not be a question any of you know how to answer, and it may be the wrong question, but the theme of police misconduct seems so salient. Michigan police that much worse than the rest of the country at those times, or did we just fight back more?
Where's Ike?
Well, I can't profess expertise, and in fact, the talk I gave, I was actually talking about the event that led to the creation of the police. But there was certainly a law enforcement presence. One of the things that is unanswerable, given the current documentation out of the 1863 event, is curious actions of the Provost Guard when they decided to kind of abandon the field as the riot was ramping up, figuring they had done their job of protecting Faulkner and getting him back to his cell. I don't know if it's better or worse, but I think that there is a long history, and Tom can probably speak to this, of the police being involved in various reactionary organizations. You see with the Black Legion, we certainly see police involvement in, as Ike talked about, in a variety of reactionary and hostile measures against the public. And we see it in involvement in those dozens of neighborhood organizations that emerge after World War II in Detroit to try to prevent integration and its fruits from becoming a reality in the city. So the police certainly have their share of guilt. Whether it's better or worse, I think post-Ferguson examples have suggested to us, whether it be Baltimore or New York or one of the most amazing overlooked incidents, the one in Beaver Creek, Ohio, a couple of years ago, the shooting of the young man who's simply buying something in Walmart. shot by the police. There certainly is a nationwide crisis that needs to be addressed. I don't think we know the scope of that crisis, but like Ike said, we need to get at it and we need to educate people. So I think Detroit has an ugly history in that regard. I don't know that we can answer the kind of relative merits of the city versus others.
Yeah, I think it's important when you think about 43, who was rioting? It was mostly younger people, teenagers, people in their 20s, mostly men, mostly white men beating, in some cases, killing black men. It did go the other way in some cases, but the majority were these white mobs being cheered on by younger crowd, often women in the crowd, cheering as they're overturning cars. But time after time, and you see this around the country, there's this sort of blaming the black community for rioting, and official reports are kind of saying blacks need to trim their sails, and they certainly represent most of the casualties of the 34 dead, overwhelmingly black, in 1943. And there are a lot of attempts to cover it up, but it's interesting, the blacks are the ones that are rioting, according to most of the official accounts, and that's kind of how the police acted in that case. Not everybody, but I think we've made great progress with our police department, not perfect.
One of the unspoken themes I would suggest from the presentations is the basic futility or lack of social control supplied by law, by statute, by constitution, by the existing legal structures in this realm. As you read about it, you see that the involvement of courts is after the fact, that there's some activity addressing these social disorders, but the law really has no role in informing or shaping attitudes of its citizenry. Tom presented about the Black Legion's activities in the 1930s, and the Michigan Supreme Court, at the end of it all, heard seven cases arising out of Black Legion matters, so principally the conspiracy conviction, which you referred to with the one-man grand jury's operation. Five of the reported cases involved affirming the discharge from employment of public officials who'd been shown to be affiliated with the Black Legion. One of the points that Greg made was the relative absence of political leadership or political influence, and one theme was lack of newspaper and press influence on shaping attitudes. Other than Justice Murphy, the example of Justice Murphy, who
yes,
both as a judge and a public mayor of the city of Detroit and later governor, definitely brought a progressive approach to race relations.
Frank Murphy is a beacon of, he's very ahead of his time, you might say.
Were there any other public officials, politicians that you revealed in your research, gentlemen, that attempted to speak out in a way which you suggested was otherwise absent in these eras?
Let me just give an additional plug for the great Frank Murphy, who was on the U.S. Supreme Court during World War II. And he wrote most important dissenting opinion in the Korematsu case about the internment of Japanese Americans. And he spoke at the courthouse on the day after VJ Day in Detroit, and he said, until we get past this sort of racial hatred in our country, we can celebrate, but the war's only half won. So Frank Murphy deserves big kudos, and he was a beacon, as I said.
There was a hue and cry by the local Republican Party, the Party of Lincoln at that time, in the aftermath, and its main organ, the Detroit Advertiser and Tribune. They saw a major problem, and they blamed a part of the media, their competitors, so there's the Detroit Free Press, but they also blamed the white working class and immigrant community for the outcome. So there's a voice saying, you know, it's not It's not the fault of the black community. However, the leadership of the Republican Party, while it was had its own political popularity, was not the party of the working class in Detroit. And the working class very much saw this as at the fault of African Americans.
Did Lincoln comment on draft riots or race riots?
Lincoln commented on the 63 riot. I don't think there was any mention of Detroit in any documents I've seen by Lincoln. But the New York City 1863 riot was of such scope that Lincoln did address it, but it was not a public pronouncement the way you might see a president do today. With that,
he might have thought I got a war to fight too. Mm-hmm.
Roy, did you mention in your remarks here that the 1863 unrest had come on the heels of the Emancipation Proclamation?
Yeah,
I think it's the confluence of two things that helped drive it, along with a lot of other contributing factors, but two very important aspects. The Emancipation Proclamation made the war, really, and in the public mind, made the war a war not just for union, but a war now for black freedom, emancipation. And that was not a politically popular view in certain circles. Lincoln had, in September 1862, he had announced in advance the coming of the Emancipation Proclamation, his preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. And there were losses in the 1862 elections in many parts of the North, particularly the lower North. But amongst the working class in the largely Democratic working class in places like Detroit and Boston and New York City and Philadelphia, there was an anger that provoked. Then when you get the Enrollment Act, you'd be drafted into a military conflict to serve in a war that you've now begun to question. The fires of anger really fueled amongst those white working men, particularly immigrant working men, who were seeing blacks, places like Detroit, as their main competitors. And so it became almost a perfect storm in many ways for the kind of conflagration you get. In a number of cities across the North, including the Midwest, Detroit's is simply the biggest. Cincinnati, Toledo, and a host of other places in 1863 and 1862 have similar kinds of riots.
We should mention that although we didn't give a lot of attention to the 1967 riots, the Law Review certainly did. In 1968, it ran a special issue completely focused on the aftermath of that unrest, and copy out on the in the hallway on the table of the directory of that issue's articles. It was shortly after the Law Review had changed its name to the Journal of Urban Law, and Dean Harbrick at the time had a special message to kick off the issue, and it really was a time when the journal was on the map nationally. Unfortunately, the reason for it wasn't altogether flattering, but the coverage from a social and a legal perspective, including articles by Judge George Crockett of the Recorder's Court, of the crisis of the bail decisions that needed to be made in the aftermath of the riots, and also the role of our urban law clinic in marshaling attorney resources to assist in that emergency over at the Detroit Recorder's Court. It really was a vibrant time, an important time for the work of both our clinic and the Law Review. Are there other questions? Who am I missing here, sir?
Professor Sumner, to get away from the idea that we're concentrating just on the warts of Detroit, since you're involved in World War II in Detroit, like we could see if you could verify a story I heard a long time ago, that at the Yalta Conference when Churchill and Roosevelt and Stalin were meeting and now discussing a post-war Europe based on a victory that was not at all assured when they first met in Tehran in November of 1943. It was Joseph Stalin who, commenting how it was that they won this war, said, and I quote, "We had Detroit."
Yes.
Is that true?
It may be an urban myth, but I cite it and I've heard it and I've quoted it. Apparently, he raised his glass at the end of the conference, vodka, and said to Detroit, the city that's winning this war, or something worse to that effect. So, to the best of my knowledge, and Stalin was not one to give compliments, so people understood Detroit was a brand during World War II, and even Stalin. You know. It's interesting, though, Goering didn't think that America could be a problem before the war. He was asked, what if the U.S. gets involved in the war? He said, oh, Americans only know how to make refrigerators and razor blades. And we sort of jammed that down his throat. So, yes, I think Marshall Stalin said that. I want to believe in it.
Professor Boyack.
I was just wondering if you could say a little bit about the population patterns in Detroit in the eras that you've been talking about. I mean, I know that I have focused a lot on the last half century or so and what's where populations are settled. And it seems like you probably had a great deal of racial segregation going on. However, then there were some interesting mentions. And this is an era that I'm not familiar with, so I'm just really curious, of sort of an integrated school, I think, and some other things. So where do people live, and when people moved to the city and the city started growing so dramatically, were populations sort of naturally segregating, or maybe not naturally, or how did that fit into this?
Well, I'll mention the Civil War era real quickly, and I think many of you have the map that I circulated around. If you see the burned areas, that was the black neighborhood at the time. There was a fairly, I think it was two things working in tandem. One, a very active effort by a lot of whites, including the city fathers, to push blacks into a separate neighborhood. And at the same time, folks coming particularly up from the south, as well as the free blacks from the upper south and northeast coming to Detroit, looking for what they saw would be welcoming neighborhoods with black institutions and so forth. So they gravitated to those places. And it's really, that remains the neighborhood until the 20th century, when you see this World War I and post-World War I explosion of black migration.
Just quickly on World War II, residential segregation was very, very much the rule, and you had suddenly thousands of new people arriving. Overwhelmingly, blacks are more or less confined to Black Bottom and a few isolated kind of neighborhoods in northwest Detroit and a couple of other places. But this gesture toward integrated housing that was the Sojourner Truth Homes, my God, it stirred such a protest, violence from the Polish neighbors of Nevada and Fenelon, at least. So integration was yet to be achieved. And Black Bottom was packed to the gills, you know.
And there was, between 1920 and 1930, we went from 1 million to 1.5 million population. The black population tripled at that point. People, of course, were coming from all over for automotive jobs. And so that lent itself partly to the Black Legion prospering there, that you had people from, you know, from the South, from the Midwest country.
One last question, Father Stoudemire.
It's not a question, it's a comment. One of our graduates in the history department, Kevin Boyle, wrote a great book about residential segregation in the 20s and 20s when he wrote the story of the Ocean Suite murder trial. It's called Arc of Justice. It came out about 7-8 years ago. That's a good read if you want to follow up.
And of course, there's Thomas Sugrue's The Origins of the Urban Crisis, which is about Detroit. He's not an alum, but it's a good book, too.
Help me with thanking our panelists for their presentation.